Hail Internet, it's Matt here for the Dork Lords. If you're new to the channel, welcome. We do all things dorkly here, so if it's fantasy, sci-fi, superheroes, we probably have a playlist on it. Today is no exception. We're talking about Lord of the Rings each week. Roughly each week, I try to take another topic from Lord of the Rings and chat about it. In fact, if you've got a topic you'd like to hear Lord of the Rings based, put it in the comments, and in future weeks, I'd be happy to do a video about it. Today's video is specifically about the Dead Marshes. So, what are they? Just to catch you up real fast, in the Two Towers, there is a chapter, where Gollum is leading Sam and Frodo through the Dead Marshes on the way to the Black Gate. The Dead Marshes are pretty much situated just outside of the Black Gate. It's a very treacherous area. Gollum knows the way through. In fact, earlier in the books, just kind of referenced and not actually seen, Aragorn captures Gollum in the Dead Marshes after Gollum has been freed from Mordor and is kind of like returning to try to find the ring somewhere. Aragorn captures him. So he knows his way around the Dead Marshes. Most people, if they went there unaided, they would also be dead. So yes, it's good to have Gollum as a guide. So what is the danger of the Dead Marshes? Now, the movie, The Two Towers, the Peter Jackson film, kind of depicts it as these candles. And in fact, the verbiage comes from the books where Gollum describes these candles of corpses in the water. And that you can only, these lights appear, and then you can only see these faces deep under the water when these lights are lit. And these are the ghostly remains, spectral images of dead soldiers. So one difference between the movie, The Two Towers, and the book is that it's not Frodo that like almost succumbs to fall into the water. It's Sam. Sam trips and he falls really close to the water, and through the surface, these lights, he can see faces under the water. And you know, Gollum tells him, "Don't look at the faces. You know, stay away." And then it's Frodo that kind of chimes in to say that he too has seen faces. And actually, I'll just read the little quick passage. This is Frodo describing what he is seeing in the Dead Marshes. This is from the book. "I have seen them too, in the pools when the candles were lit. They lie in all the pools, pale faces, deep, deep, under the dark water. I saw them, grim faces and evil, and noble faces and sad, many faces proud and fair, and weeds in their silver hair, but all foul, all rotting, all dead. A fell light is in them." So he's seeing these phantoms as well. I think of them, I mean, the film did a good job at depicting what that might look like, you know, in movie terms, but I kind of feel like the lights, even though they mentioned candles, I think what Tolkien was heading for was more of a will-o'-the-wisp idea. And the Wills of the Wisp are fairy lights, right? So they're supposedly either the spectral energy of the dead or fairies, and they lure people into the swamp and, you know, never to be seen again. So they're kind of mischievous spirits. And I think that may be if you were to do a different take on it, I think maybe a Will of the Wisp take might be a different directorial choice you could have made in this situation. So a lot of what we're seeing comes back to two battles, one in particular. So there were a few different fights that happened. Obviously, you're near the Black Gate, you're near a very crucial place territory wise in Middle Earth. So wars have been fought in this area, and it's a swampland, so people are gonna die and be difficult to retrieve and bury. So, for instance, there was a fight. Gondor had a big battle in the Third Age with the Wainriders, and there was a major conflict there, the chariots, and it was a big deal, and a lot of people died in that area. But those were humans. And what we are told, and what we're actually seeing in the film as well, are elves specifically. And so that the fact that we're talking about elves places it with a very specific battle. And that battle is the Battle of Dagorlad, which takes place in the Second Age. This is the War of the Last Alliance. So if you remember in the films, Fellowship of the Ring, we see that montage in the beginning, the War of the Last Alliance. It's Elrond, and he's, you know, you've got Elendil and Isildur, and they're fighting against Sauron, and they chop off Sauron's finger. All right, that was the final battle. This is the battle before the final battle. So the penultimate battle. It also, there was a siege in between, so there's a few years of siege happens before the final battle. But to get to the Black Gate and to be able to lay siege to Barad-dûr and bring Sauron out for that final battle, this battle happened. It's the Battle of Dagorlad. So named because of the plain of Dagorlad. It's this big plain area, but near the plain is this swamp area. It was not called the Dead Marshes at the time because there weren't a whole bunch of dead people in it, but it was marshland. So huge forces from elves and men have gathered, and this is their big push. And obviously, eventually, they're successful. You've got the leader of the elves is Gil-galad. Elrond, he's gathered the various elven kings. So you've got Elrond from Rivendell, boom, he's there. You've got Lorien, turned out, Lothlorien, but Lorien arrives, and they are led by King Amdir. And then you've also got Greenwood, the kings of the woodland realm, they arrive as well. And that king is Orifer. So you've got these three elven kings that are kind of underneath Gil-galad: Elrond, Orifer, and Amdir. And on the human side, you've got Elendil, his brother Anarion, you've got Gondor, they're all there, so it's a huge, huge army. But they're tactically well set out, and there's orcs on the other side, and they're getting ready for a major conflict. But you've got some dissension in the ranks of the elves. Specifically, the king of the woodland realm, Orifer, and Lorien, Amdir, decide, you know what? We know better than this Gil-galad guy. Let's take the offensive and finish this up. And so they charge the orcs prematurely. Everybody's like, "What? Wait, where'd you go?" And they've led a charge unsupported, and they get routed. In fact, both of those elves get killed. Both of the kings get killed in this fight, and they're pushed back into the marsh, and they die in this the mud and muck of the marsh. Orifer is notable because he is Legolas's granddad. So if you remember, say from the Hobbit movies, for instance, you see a lot of Thranduil, who at that time is the king of the woodland realm. Thranduil is Orifer's son, Legolas's dad. Thranduil is there at this battle and witnesses his father being killed, and he returns with what's left of their army back to the woodland realm. Kind of like, hey, that was a bad outcome. I believe in the case of the Woodland Realm elves, there was an attempt to bury them outside of the swamp, like pick them up and bury them. They had, the siege happened soon thereafter, and so there was plenty of time to do this. And they did. They buried everybody on the shoreline, but then over the next 1,000 or 2 years, the swamp spread out. And so even though they were originally buried on dry land, the swamp overtook them, and they were once again unburied, and so their spirits are haunting this swamp. In the case of the elves of Lorien, there's some notes from Unfinished Tales that say that Frodo, Sam, and Gollum, when they're making their way through the swamp, that those are the elves that they are walking through. So it's specifically the defeated company of Amdir and the elves of Lorien. There's even a you can make a case that there's that specific elf that who's, you know, the death, you don't see the pupils, just the dead eyes that tries to lure Frodo to his death. Maybe you make the case that that is Amdir himself. Maybe it's a very special elf. That's the reason that Frodo has been entranced. Yeah, I don't think there's, you know, who knows? We'll say it. We'll say it's Amdir. Sure, why not? interestingly, the inspiration, the gruesome inspiration for the dead marshes from Tolkien's point of view was when he, you know, he was in World War I. He was a teenager, late teens. He's in World War I. He's at the Battle of the Somme. Trench warfare, just horrible, horrible stuff. And he had noted that, you know, in these cratered areas, the battlefield had these giant craters, explosion craters. They got filled with water. And he remembered seeing in these craters, these water-filled craters, dead bodies just floating in these pools. And so, you know, for instance, this thing where he has Frodo talking about grim faces and noble faces and proud faces and fair faces, but all dead. I think that, you know, that the horror of that moment and seeing that translated itself into the dead marshes in this world. So it's kind of a way that he could deal with the visions that he had in his head from World War I. Those are really the important points, I think, about the dead marshes. It's a really interesting backstory. The fact that you've got this connection to the woodland realm there as well. And so there you go. It's the dead marshes, everybody. Hope you enjoyed it. Feel free to subscribe. If you want some specific Tolkien video done, let me know. And I'm happy to do a video on a topic of your choosing. So thanks again, and bye, everybody.